بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا ومعلمنا وقدوتنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اليوم إن شاء الله just a summary للبرزنتيشن اللي كانت قبل كده. We already did two presentation for hypokalemia because already we have just around three cases the last two weeks. This is the most important topic. Just I will give you just summary for our clinical approach to any patient with hypokalemia. Not all hypokalemia patients simple just replace the potassium, but we need to investigate maybe underlying any other disease. And we'll see by this diagram how we can go from A to Z, how we can approach it to diagnose if any patient with hypokalemia. Today, I will just give summary for previous two presentation for hypokalemia. أولا بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، قالوا سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم، صدق الله العظيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، وقل اعملوا فسيرى الله عملكم ورسوله والمؤمنون، صدق الله العظيم. نبدأ بالصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا ومعلمنا وقدوتنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. If you don't know or you can't improve what you don't understand. Just this slide, I try to repeat in my presentation, and because you should know to improve your work or your management for your patient. You can't improve what you don't understand. We need today. I need you from today to understand how you can approach to any patient with hypokalemia, either with general internal medicine or either in ICU or either under care of nephrology. First, any hypokalemia, serum potassium less than 3.5. This is the definition of hypokalemia. Either just two different big differential diagnosis, either potassium shift or potassium loss, either shift or loss. This is the main two causes of hypokalemia. This patient, your patient, either under shift or loss, loss from renal or extrarenal. And we'll see now. First step, I need you to take picture from this approach. When you receive any consult for hypokalemia or resistance hypokalemia or persistent hypokalemia, especially from internal medicine, and ask for help from nephrology team, you should understand how you can approach it to your patient. Just for first hypokalemia definition, potassium serum potassium less than 0.3, 0.5 millimole or mole equivalent per liter. And second step, don't forget to take details history from your patient. Focus on any medication that cause hypokalemia. Any GIT symptoms like persistent vomiting or diarrhea can cause hypokalemia. Any renal disease also can cause hypokalemia, either genetic or acquired. And blood pressure, what is your patient hypotensive or hypertensive? Any weakness or paralysis? Physical exam for your patient, be your patient overloaded or volume depleted? According to your assessment, and focus on in extracellular fluid volume, GVB, and blood pressure to check your patient is volume contracted or overloaded. And ask when you receive the consult, you can ask for some of this, and you can examine your patient when you see the patient physically. And you can ask for labs, lights, EBG or VBG, whatever available. And don't forget serum magnesium. And if the patient hypertensive, please just ask for serum aldosterone and renin. And urolytes, osmolarity, especially urine potassium and creatinine, other calcium urea also. 24 hours urine potassium, creatinine, and osmolarity if possible. And you can do a spot sample also. But first step, diagnose of hypo. What is your referred patient already referred for you? Because hypokalemia is the first step. What is hypokalemia? Less than 0.3, 0.5 millimole per deciliter. Second step, you should take full details of history and the labs for your patient. Third step, what is urine? This is the first key of your diagnosis. What is the urine potassium divided by urine creatinine by millimole per millimole? What is the ratio between urine potassium and urine creatinine? This is a key test for diagnosis of your hyperkalemia, either renal loss or non-renal loss. Renal loss, if urine potassium to creatinine more than 2, this equal urine loss, and you will see also urine potassium more than 20 millimole per day. Okay, this with renal loss. Other than non-renal loss, if urine potassium to urine creatinine less than 2, and the urine potassium less than 20 millimole per day. The first, after this, the most key steps is number 3, we'll go to check your metabolic acid base disturbance. You ask for EBG or VBG, or check your patient metabolic acid disorders, either metabolic acidosis or metabolic alkalosis or no acid base. If your patient with urine potassium to creatinine less than 2 with non-renal loss or urine potassium less than 20 non-renal loss, if no acid base disturbance, this means your potassium hypokalemia secondary to shift. Shift means from extracellular to intracellular. Either from your patient taking insulin or beta adrenergic or bicarb or patient in paralysis, all this can lead to potassium shift from extracellular to intracellular. Okay, take care from that. Insulin, beta adrenergic, patient receives salbutamol, or for any patient was receiving an immobilizer for bronchial asthma, or patient received bicarb or paralysis, all this lead to acute shift from extracellular to intracellular. Simply, if urine potassium to creatinine less than 2 non-renal loss with metabolic acidosis, this is diarrhea. This will go with diarrhea. Just check from your examination and history, or you can rule this out. And if your patient metabolic alkalosis and urine potassium to create less than 2 non-renal, this means extra renal potassium loss, either your patient congenital chloride hosting diarrhea or laxative abuse. We saw this one patient last week on 3 laxative medication, dialysis patient, and 3 for his constipation, and the patient already with diarrhea and the skin, especially patient with cystic fibrosis. If the patient just from history, if your lung problem or respirology problem with cystic fibrosis or renal potassium loss, either remote diuretic use or vomiting, remote diuretic use or vomiting, this is a cause of metabolic alkalosis, vomiting or remote diuretic use, this from renal loss, extra renal loss with metabolic alkalosis, either chloride hosting diarrhea, laxative abuse, cystic fibrosis. Now, we reach now the key of diagnosis, urine potassium to creatinine, millimole per millimole, and urine potassium to creatinine less than 2, non-renal loss, or urine potassium less than 20. Will check acid metabolic acid base disorder. If no acid base disorder, this means acute shift from extracellular to intracellular, either insulin, beta adrenergic, and bicarb or paralysis. If a patient with metabolic acid base disorder, metabolic acidosis with diarrhea, metabolic alkalosis, either extrarenal or renal loss, extrarenal chloride wasting diarrhea, laxative abuse, cystic fibrosis, renal potassium loss, either remote diuretic use or vomiting. This is the first step, just to take a picture for that, and you will go to your patient. Just for here, if no acid-base disturbance and urine potassium creatinine less than 2, will go to shift. Hypokalemia secondary to shift. Is there high adrenergic surge or no? High adrenergic surge, what is the criteria? Systolic hypertension, wide pulse pressure, and tachycardia. Systolic hypertension, wide pulse pressure, and tachycardia. Your patient with high adrenergic surge, if yes, beta adrenergic agonist, either patient stress with heat trauma, subarachnoid hemorrhage, MI, drug like amphetamine, ephedrine, albuterol, and salbutamol, or alcohol withdrawal, caffeine overdose, insulin, bicarb, cytotoxic periodic paralysis, all this was high adrenergic surge. If no high adrenergic surge, no systolic hypertension, no white pulse pressure, no tachycardia, then with familial periodic paralysis, sporadic periodic paralysis, potassium channel blocker, you know, this is MRCP exam, patient chafing his hair, and it was using barium sulfide. This barium sulfide also lead to potassium shift, anabolic post DKA, and a patient taking vitamin B12 for pernicious anemia. All this lead to potassium shift intracellular from extracellular to intracellular, and lead to hypokalemia from potassium shift, especially if no high adrenergic surge like this medication or disease. When do you suspect shift? If sudden onset, severe hypokalemia associated with weakness, rapid recovery, no obvious cause, no diarrhea, no vomiting, no diuretic. You should ask for this from history, any diarrhea, vomiting, diuretic, no acid-base disorders, urine potassium not high. And this summary for all causes of hypokalemia due to shift into cells. As we mentioned before, alcohol was catecholamines, endogenous like alcohol withdrawal, stress head injury, subarachnoid hemorrhage, pheochromocytoma, insulinoma, cytotoxicosis, exogenous beta 2 agonists, salbutamol for bronchial asthma and other, and sympathomimetic, like amphetamine and caffeine and cervelin. Insulin and repeating syndrome, insulin given to a patient with DKA, all this can lead to hypokalemia. Bicarb also can lead. Vitamin B12 for pernicious anemia or the barium sulfate, this potassium channel blocker, all this can lead to acute hypokalemia from shift potassium from extracellular to intracellular. This summary also for shift. Now, we finish now urine potassium to creatinine if less than 2, either with metabolic acid-based disorder, acidosis, diarrhea, alkalosis, extranenal chloride, Wolff-Osteen diarrhea, laxative abuse, cystic fibrosis, or renal loss, remote diuretic use, or vomiting, or no acid-based disorders. This means acute shift, and we talk about shift already. The second issue for urine potassium to creatinine more than 2, this means renal loss, and you will find urine sodium or urine potassium more than 20 millimole per day. Now we'll go now to this second differential diagnosis, urine potassium to creatinine more than 2, renal loss. How you can approach to urine potassium to creatinine more than 2 with renal loss and urine potassium more than 20 millimole per day. We'll check if the first step is metabolic acid disorders or no. If metabolic acidosis is hypercholeremic metabolic acidosis, diarrhea, distal RTA, proximal RTA treated with bicarb, carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, acetazolamide topiramate, and ureteral diversion. This is metabolic acid-based disorders. Again, we'll check here if urine potassium to creatinine more than 2, and urine potassium more than 20 millimole, metabolic acid-based disorder, acidosis, hypercholeremic metabolic acidosis, either with diarrhea, distal RTA, proximal RTA treated with bicarb, carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, acetazolamide topiramate, ureteral diversion. If metabolic alkalosis will take some time here, if my patient urine potassium to creatinine more than 2 and my acid-base disturbance with metabolic alkalosis, I will go to examine my patient for extra arterial blood volume assessment, and this extracellular and GVB, for especially for GVB for your patient and the blood pressure, if normal or high, normal or low or normal or high. Either low or normal, this is the same category, or high, this is a different category. Approach now by urine chloride. When I reach to this step, urine potassium to creatinine more than 2, metabolic alkalosis with high blood pressure or low blood pressure, approach will go to urine chloride. How to can approach to this by urine chloride? Now we reach here either hypertensive or hypotensive. With the urine chloride more than 20, we'll go down now to this hypotension or normotension. If the urine chloride more than 20 millimole or milli equivalent per liter, or less than 20 milli equivalent per liter, and hypertension will go directly to urine chloride more than 20 milli equivalent per liter. If your patient hypertensive with this chloride more than 20, just will ask check renin aldosterone. Okay, direct in hypertension, metabolic alkalosis, hypokalemia, renin aldosterone direct. If your patient normal or hypotension with urine chloride more or less than 20, we'll go now. Normal or hypotension, urine chloride less than 20 with vomiting or patient in GT tubes, suction, congenital chloride wasting diarrhea, post hypercapnia, laxative abuse, a loop or cyazide, remote, if less than this remote diuretic. If urine chloride more than 20 and persistence, urine chloride more than 20 and the persistence because we have intermittent high urine chloride with diuretic, intermittent high urine chloride with diuretic, and we have persistence more than 20 milliequivalent per liter, either Bartter or Gitelman or recent cyazide or loop diuretic, okay, I think that clear now. We reach now to urine potassium to creatinine more than 2, this is renal loss, and we'll check the extra arterial blood volume. and the blood pressure if hypertension or hypotension. Hypertension will go now, and this normal tension, hypotension according to the urine chloride if less than 20 or more than 20. Less than 20, vomiting, GT tube suction, congenital chloride, wasting diarrhea, post hypercapnia, excessive abuse, loops as a diuretic, remote, less than 20, remote. More than 20 is recent diuretic, with Bartter and Gentleman's syndrome. Intermittent high-low, this is with diuretic, okay? This now normal or hypotension. With hypertension, we'll check renin, aldosterone, Liddle syndrome, as we know, Liddle syndrome, low, renal vascular hypertension, high renin, high aldosterone, exogenous mineralocorticoid, low, licorice, low, and primary hyperbara, we know low renin and high aldosterone. And we'll just summarize here, high aldosterone, high renin, more than 400, more than 20 nanogram per liter, and it becomes mole per liter. High with renin secreting tumor, renal artery stenosis, malignant hypertension. If this aldosterone high and renal low, this, with primary, this Cohen syndrome, primary hyperaldosteronism with adrenal adenoma, hyperplasia, or glucocorticoid remediable hyperaldosteronism also with high aldosterone and low renin. If it's low aldosterone and low renin, this is the most common with Liddle syndrome and licorice and ectopic ATH, genetic lake of 11 beta hydroxysteroid, dihydrogenase and the cortisol act like aldosterone, all this with low. Okay, I think that's clear. Persistence urine chloride more than 20, as we mentioned, persistence urine chloride not intermittent was diuretic, persistent high more than 20 milliequivalent per liter. This was Bartter syndrome, defect in sick ascending limb, this Bartter syndrome equal 24-hour Lasix intake. Gittleman syndrome, defect in a distal conferred tubule, this equal 24-hour cyazide intake. Gittleman versus Bartter, hypomagnesemia and hypocalciuria with Gittleman to differentiate hypomagnesemia, hypocalciuria. Liddle syndrome, this mutation in ENaC channel hypertension also is hypokalemia. Acquired Bartter either in hypercalcemia, aminoglycoside, cisplatin, and cationic protein from multiple myeloma and stimulate calcium sensing receptors. This acquired Bartter syndrome. And this genetic syndrome, this is the differential diagnosis between Bartter and Gittleman. Just this mean thick ascending limb and this in distal conferred tubule, this sodium potassium 2 chloride channel and this potassium chloride co-transporter channel in distal conferred tubules. And the differential diagnosis here by magnesium and the urinary calcium. Mainly Gittleman with hypomagnesemia, but both already with hypomagnesemia, but already this with hypocalciuria, this Gittleman syndrome, because it's like cyazide, intake for 24 hours. This decreases calcium excretion already. This will be hypocalciuria in comparison with Bartter syndrome. And both already with metabolic alkalosis, yeah, and the normal blood pressure. Don't forget this also, just to remind you from previous presentation, hypokalemia before, why hypomagnesemia? Why I'm checking magnesium in mini consult for hypokalemia? Because you know, magnesium here in this ROMK channel, already this work as a guard here, Harris هنا للمغنيسيوم بيمنع حروب المغنيسيوم هنا لأن ده positive charge will not allow to potassium to escape to the lumen of the tubules and will excrete it. So if المغنيسيوم is low, this already will not be here and the potassium is easy to escape from the intracellular to the lumen of the tubule to the urine. This is the mechanism of hypomagnesemia as we discussed here already, and the inflammation of hypomagnesemia will lead to ventricular torsade de Bruyne. If you remember in cardiology already, you should check any hypomagnesemia. And if you see this like ventricular tachycardia with torsade de Bruyne, hypokalemia and metabolic alkalosis. Hypokalemia and metabolic alkalosis commonly occur together. Hypokalemia causes metabolic alkalosis. What is the mechanism? Because the potassium depletion lead to potassium shift out of the cell and shift the hydrogen ion into the cell. Cell including the kidney, especially in the kidney tubules, cells are acidified, especially proximal tubular cells. Kidney increase excretion of ammonium and increase reabsorption. And increase the absorption by carbs, this lead to metabolic alkalosis. This is what is the mechanism of hypokalemia and metabolic alkalosis. How we can replace the potassium deficit, either oral either in food or just by salt substitute, 12 millimol per gram. We need daily around 60 to 80 millimol per day. Our potassium chloride tablet, each tablet scale 600 milligram equal 8 millimol. 1,500 milligram equal 20 millimoles. Liquid and potassium syrup, 20 millimol per 15 ml. Oral potassium citrate, also available, 10 milli equivalent, 25 milli equivalent tablet. Intravenous KCL, bolus in ICU via central line, 20 millimol per 100 ml CC normal saline, peripheral IV, up to 40 millimol per liter, up to 20 to 40 millimol per hours. This in ICU via central line. Just a rough estimation, mild to moderate, just will give KCL per oral 10 to 20 BID or QID. And total dose per day, just 20 to 80 milliequivalent per day. This is a daily requirement. Severe or symptomatic, less than 2.5, either 40 TID, or you can give KCL IV 10 to 20 milliequivalent per hour. And this total maximum daily dose, either 160 per oral or 480. Don't forget, this can do gastritis, should be given with juice like that, and a huge amount of fluid. Life-threatening cardiac arrhythmia, respiratory muscle weakness, and rhabdomyolysis is the side effect of hypokalemia, cardiac arrhythmia, respiratory muscle weakness, and rhabdomyolysis, as we discussed in the previous presentation in details before. KCL IV, 40 mL equivalent per hour until complication control, should be in cardiac monitoring. High IV calcium can cause phlebitis, take care from that. So we need, in this situation, central line and giving 40 mL equivalent per hour. Okay. Avoid to make worse. Don't put any KCL with D5. This will lead to increased insulin and increase more shift. Don't mix KCL with D5 water. Don't give also with bicarb. All this will lead to shift of potassium intracellular and will lead worse your hypokalemia. Treat the underlying cause, treat the specific underlying disorder, correct the associated hypomagnesemia, correct of the hypokalemia may not occur until the hypomagnesemia. You should correct the hypomagnesemia if already present, otherwise your patient would not be corrected. Just in the summary للهايبوكاليميا أتمنى إن شاء الله تكونوا استفدتوا اليوم من السمري ده. أنا قدمت طبعا two presentation before in details for هايبوكاليميا، بس أنا حبيت أعمل ريفيو معاكم بحيث إن أنا حاولت ألخص موضوع الهايبوكاليميا بحيث أنت لو جالك حالة تعرف إزاي تتعامل معاه بسرعة، لأن المحاضرة التانية كانت طويلة شوية للأسف. أنا هحاول إن شاء الله أحاول أجيب لكم المفيد في كل الحالات اللي اتقدمت وفي الحالات القادمة بإذن الله. ودائما نسألكم الدعاء بالصحة والستر والعافية والبركة في الأولاد والمال والأهل، ولا تنسونا من صالح الدعاء بالبركة في الوقت والمال والأهل والأولاد، ولا تنسونا من صالح الدعاء، ونلقاكم إن شاء الله قريبا على خير، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. ولا تنسوا دائما الصلاة والسلام على حبيبنا ومعلمنا وقدوتنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونلقاكم بفيديو قادم إن شاء الله قريبا، ونترككم في رعاية الله وحفظه، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.